You good? His grace is enough. That's a good message for us this morning, right? When you walk in after a week of busy and crazy, it's good to know that God's grace is enough. So it's good to see you. If we don't know each other, my name is Greg, and it's a pleasure to greet you this morning. If you're online with us this morning, we're glad you're with us. I want to encourage you, if you're new to Anchor, whether it's your first time here, or maybe we just don't know very much about you yet, we'd love for you to stop by the commons area out there. There's some buckets on the tables, and fill out one of these connect cards and let us get to know you better, help us communicate better with you, and kind of keep you filled in with everything that's going on in the life of the church. Speaking of getting to know more about Anchor, next week, next Sunday, we're going to start two classes. One of those classes is our Discover Anchor class, which is a class that we do roughly every trimester to invite anyone who's new to Anchor or interested in more about Anchor or interested in membership at Anchor to participate in, go through those few weeks of just conversation and connection and get to know more about Anchor. So I want to invite you. That's at 9 o'clock starting next Sunday morning, and that will be back here in this room just before you go out the front doors. And then next week in here at 9 o'clock, we're going to start a new study, a new teaching study called The Story of God. And that sounds about as fundamental as you can possibly imagine, doesn't it? But really, it's a historic journey through Scripture from Genesis to Revelation over 8 weeks. And you're like, that's a lot over 8 weeks, right? But yeah, there's some milestones throughout Scripture that we'll go through and do that. So we're going to be teaching through that. I'll be teaching part of that. And then I think Lee and maybe Matt and we'll be enjoying that right here, 9 o'clock. Now, here's the deal. Did Lee, did you even know that? Okay, just checking. Make sure. That's in here. Here's the deal, though. You got to be here at 9, all right? You got to be here at 9, because otherwise, you know, it's an hour and 15 minutes. If you're 30 minutes late, you miss the meet. So I want to encourage you, be here at 9 o'clock and be part of it. I think it's going to be a fantastic study. I'm excited to be part of it. And so, hey, that's it. We're going to pray, and we're going to keep going. Thank you. I don't know, this morning I walked in just thankful for so many people every Sunday morning that walk in the doors here early, that create an environment that we get to enjoy and be part of, whether it's at the front door or handing out bulletins or even before that, teaching our children and our youth and being part of that, our praise team that's always here, our tech team that's always here early. Would you just tell them thank you real quick, because I think it's always good to remember that there's so much that happens that wouldn't happen if it wasn't for people that use their gifts and their calling and skills, and really it's just a reflection of their love for us and each other. And I think that's just an incredible picture of God working through the life of His church. So let's why don't you go ahead and stand with me? Let's go ahead and pray together, and we're going to continue to worship. Just take a moment here for a second, and as we were just singing for a minute, just bow your heads for a second and just remembering that God's grace is enough. I don't know what you walked in here this morning with, but I know that the past few weeks for me have been just busy, and there's been illness in our family and just all kinds of stuff. And it's easy to walk in this morning with all kinds of things that could take away from your attention and your affection and your worship. So would you just, in a moment of silence, just ask the Lord to give you breath that just gives you release and relief from those things, so that our time together might be all about Him. Father, our lives are all about You. The breath that is in our lungs this morning is because You gave it to us so that we could pour out our love and our worship to You. Father, it's not something that just happens here this morning, but that is our lives every moment of every day. And Father, we need You to fill us up with more of You. God, there's so much stuff going in the lives of everybody in this room. We're busy. Our lives are filled up with things: work, family obligations, school, the stuff going on at the house right now. Lord, the car's not running right. Money's tight. Father, You're enough. And we need to be reminded of that more this morning. And as we're reminded, God, let our worship be poured out to You. Father, would You receive all praise and glory for everything that happens here this morning? Would our worship be honoring and glorifying to You, Jesus? We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Jesus, all I want is you. Wherever you lead me, whatever it costs me, all I want is you. Jesus, all I want is you. Wherever you lead me, whatever it costs me, all I want is you. Jesus, all I want is you. You are the refuge I run to. You are the fire that leads me through the night. I'll follow you anywhere. There's a million reasons to trust you. Nothing to fear, for you.
There is Scripture today is from Ricky.
Good morning. Today I'll be reading from Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 1 through 8. In the month of Nisan, in the 20th year of King Artaxerxes, when wine was before him, I took up the wine and gave it to the king. Now I had not been sad in his presence, and the king said to me, "Why is your face sad, seeing you are not sick? This is nothing but sadness of the heart." Then I was very much afraid. I said to the king, "Let the king live forever. Why should not my face be sad when the city, the place of my father's graves, lies in ruins, and its gates have been destroyed by fire?" Then the king said to me, "What are you requesting?" So I prayed to the God of heaven, and I said to the king, "If it pleases the king, and if your servant has found favor in your sight, that you send me to Judah, to the city of my father's graves, that I may rebuild it." And the king said to me, the queen sitting beside him, "How long will you be gone, and when will you return?" So it pleased the king to send me when I had given him a time. And I said to the king, "If it pleases the king, let letters be given me to the governors of the province beyond the river, that they may let me pass through until I come to Judah. And a letter to Asaph, the keeper of the king's forest, that he may give me timber to make beams for the gates of the fortress of the temple, and for the wall of the city, and for the house that I shall occupy." And the king granted me what I asked, for the good hand of my God was upon me. Bow with me and pray. Lord, we are so grateful that you are a God that remembers his promises and a God that remembers his people. And you are so good that you don't let us forget that, that you send us reminders daily, Lord, of your love and the promises that you continue to keep, Lord. And I just humbly ask that this morning that we be open to these reminders that you constantly place in front of us, Lord, and that our hearts are open to the message that Matt is coming to share with us today, Lord. And that you just let it sit and resonate in our hearts today, this week, moving forward, Lord, that we will be more open to seeing all of these wonderful gifts that you provide us, Lord. And I just pray for that today. In your name, amen.
A.W. Tozer famously said, "Nothing less than a whole Bible can make a whole Christian." Welcome to The Story of God. We are going to see the story of the whole Bible, written by 40 different human authors, ultimately inspired and breathed by God, over 1,500 years, 66 different books, but really one story, one overarching story of God's plan. One overarching story of the greatest rescue, the greatest hero, one overarching story that you've been invited into. And the more you understand the story of God, the better you will see your place in his great story.
Hey, there we go. That was me. I'm glad you're here. Good morning, everybody. This video is a trailer for our Bible study, as Greg mentioned, that starts next Sunday at 9. And I wanted to just add a couple of things. Greg did such a great job, but I'm going to add a little bit to it. I have had a couple of folks come and say, you know, periodically throughout this process of establishing classes on Sunday morning, well, we do prayer at 9 o'clock. That's something that's been established. So here's what I want to encourage. If you're involved in prayer ministry, or even if you're not, I want to invite you to come at 8:30. We're going to actually meet right in here. We're going to pray for 30 minutes. Then we're going to all step into class together at 9 o'clock. And then we're going to spend the last 10 minutes of class praying for our worship service. And so we really, like, don't want to lay down what God is doing in and through the prayer ministry of our church. But we also want to take up opportunities to be shaped and developed as we enter like some times of coming in and studying Scripture together. And so if you're new to the church, we have a Discover class. We really want to encourage you to go to that ahead of the other classes. And so that's for you. It starts next week as well. And that'll be in the first room on the when you're coming in the building on the right in this building. And then everybody else, like join me and Greg and others in here at 9 o'clock. And if you want to come pray, please do that. Come at 8:30. We're going to open God's Word together and get a sense of the grand story of God throughout Scripture. You know, one of my very favorite professors in college, he was mostly an Old Testament professor. One of the things he did in every class was he opened up with a list of dates and happenings from the beginning of Genesis all the way like through today. And then he would, second week of class, would test us on all the major dates. And I probably took that same test three times. The first time I did terrible. But by the third time, I was like, okay, I got it. I know where Moses fits in the story. I know where Noah fits in the story. I have a sense of where Nehemiah fits in the story. And so when you gain a big picture sense of God's story throughout history, you begin to be able to like approach all of Scripture with its context and understand kind of where it fits in God's own unfolding plan. And then like Eric Geiger, the pastor at a church out in California, said, you know, it's an opportunity also for us to see that God's writing a story that he's invited us into, and he has a purpose for us in his grand story. So this morning, turn with me to Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 1 through 8. Ricky did a great job reading this text this morning. It's the third sermon in a series we've been calling Rebuild, the Story of Nehemiah. So let me give you a little bit of background. What happened in chapter 1 is actually critical to our understanding of chapter 2. So that's usually actually how it works. You know, you can't plop down in the middle of a book of the Bible and really get a full understanding of where it's going or what it means without the context. And so I want to take a minute to review. A couple of weeks ago, we opened up this series in Nehemiah 1, 1 through 4, where we discovered that God changes the hearts of ordinary people, calling them to build, in Nehemiah's case, a wall and some gates and God's people. In our case, to build disciples, to be involved as God's hands and his feet, to build the church, to be instruments in his hands, to build the kingdom of God in the world. And so Nehemiah's story was to rebuild the wall. Our case, it's to be used of God to build his church and his kingdom. In Nehemiah's story, he receives news. You remember those first few verses from his brother Hanani saying, concerning the Jews who escaped, who have survived the exile, and concerning Jerusalem, this was the news that he was receiving. Hanani told him that the remnant there in the province who had survived the exile is in great trouble and in great shame. And he delivered the news that the wall of Jerusalem was broken down and its gates were destroyed by fire. Now, in our story, the world is lost in sin and brokenness. And the church needs, in a lot of respects, all over the world, needs revitalization. So we can bring people who are outside of Christ and are in need of Christ to the hope of Jesus. So when Nehemiah hears the terrible news, the text says, sat down and wept and mourned for days and continued fasting and praying before the God of heaven. So in our context, the revitalization of God's church, the work of God's church, begins with us also having a broken heart over lostness in our community and a passion to see God's church be effective in reaching the world around us. Notice the word in the first few verses, specifically verse 4, the word continued. This word really is a springboard from which we like land in chapter 2. It's important because it shows Nehemiah didn't just like pray the prayer that we find in verses 5 through 11 just one time. No, he actually like continued. Verse 6 says, day and night, until God moved beyond the conviction and the calling that God had placed on Nehemiah's heart. So Nehemiah desired to be used of the Lord, desired to be led of the Lord, desired to be empowered of the Lord, but he didn't know where to go or what to do or how he was going to get from A to B. He didn't have the resources, and so he continually prayed in ways that reflected verses 5 through 11. He prayed continually day and night in this way, with consistent fasting and prayer. And the truth is, this is what we drew out of that first week. Really, any work that God calls us people to engage in, it begins there. Before the Lord, God breaks our hearts. He changes our hearts. He does a work in us. And he calls us to yearn to be a part of what he's doing in the world. And we find ourselves at times in places where we're like, I'm not sure how, or I'm not sure how God's going to enable this, or how I'm going to be equipped and prepared for this. But we know God's put a calling on our lives and a burden in our hearts because our hearts have been changed. And so when we don't know what to do, we begin with prayer. We give ourselves to the work of fasting and prayer and wait for God to move. Notice chapter 2 opens up this way. In the month of Nisan, in the 20th year of King Artaxerxes. So if you're paying really close attention, like, and you looked at verse 1 in chapter 1 and verse 1 in chapter 2, you actually hear 2 months that sound weird. Anybody else with me on that? It's like there's no January or February or March. We've got a couple of strange names. This is actually the Jewish calendar. Chapter 1 opens up. Now, it happened in the month of Chislev in the 20th year, so same year, as I was in Susa, the citadel. So Chislev and Nisan are both months in the ancient Jewish calendar. So if you do just a little bit of research, you find that there's 4 months between these months. 4 months have passed since Nehemiah received the news about God's people in the wall and the gates and this destruction and the continued like suffering of God's people. So lean into this. Nehemiah prayed, remember, day and night for 4 months and had no plans to stop praying until God moved. Do you recognize that? Like, Nehemiah's praying month after month after month after month. God, and there's all of these things we talked about last week that were characteristics of Nehemiah's prayer. And in that time, God was at work in the world, orchestrating circumstances, in the work inside the king's heart, and God was at work inside Nehemiah, preparing Nehemiah to be a part of what God had planned for the city, for the walls, and for his people through Nehemiah's life. So here's the big idea this morning. If you're taking notes, which we encourage you to do, we want you to be able to take the truth home that we explore in God's Word today, so that you can remember some of it, so that you can think through it and pray through it, and allow the Holy Spirit to continue to work through your life. As a matter of fact, this isn't an out on note-taking, but about midweek every week, we send out a prayer list, and on the front of the prayer list, there's some notes related to the sermon and some call to prayer that reflects where we've been in the Word. We post that same information on our new church blog on our website, so you can find that usually Thursday, Friday morning on the blog. And so, but I want to encourage you, you're going to miss Monday, Tuesday, and all day Wednesday if you're not taking notes. So I want to encourage you to take notes. And then there may be things that the Lord leads you to that we don't put in that document. So I want to encourage you. So here's the big idea for this morning. God moves through faithful fasting and prayer to prepare his people and to provide for their mission. It's on the screen. God moves through faithful fasting and prayer to prepare his people and to provide for their mission. So in the time between receiving the news and God empowering the mission, Nehemiah fasted and he prayed. And in last Sunday's message from Nehemiah 1, 5 through 11, we learned Nehemiah's prayers. Here's some characteristics. They submitted to the lordship of God. Nehemiah submitted to the lordship of God. That's the work that God did in him, and it's the heart from which Nehemiah prayed was him being submitted under the lordship of his king. Nehemiah's prayers recognized the awesomeness of God. They saw God for who he was and recognized his greatness and his glory and his power. So Nehemiah's prayers submitted the lordship of God, recognized the awesomeness of God. They trusted in God's promises and in his steadfast love. Nehemiah clung to the promises of God, and in looking towards what he may call Nehemiah to do, and as God's shaping that, he's trusting that God loves him. He loves his people. He loves the city that he has established. And so Nehemiah is trusting in God's promises and his love. Through Nehemiah's prayers, we see Nehemiah reaffirming his commitment to obedience. To say, okay, I'm under the lordship of God. I see the glory and the awesomeness of God. And because of that, I'm deeply committed to whatever God says I'm going to do. Whatever God says I'm going to do. We see in Nehemiah's prayers that he cried out to God for help. God, help! Help me know what to do. Help our people. God, move on our behalf. We learned that Nehemiah's prayers were continual. We even talked about in the New Testament where it calls us to pray continually, to pray without ceasing. He prayed day and night. We learned last week that his prayers were others-oriented. He prayed for their help. He prayed for their salvation. We saw that his prayers included confession of sin. You know, you can't sit before under the lordship of God, before the glory of God, in awe of God for long without seeing yourself rightly and without the Spirit of God convicting your heart and leading you to confess and repent of the sins that cling closely. We saw in Nehemiah's prayer that he called upon God to remember his word and his promises and his people. I actually had a couple of questions about this last week after church, because we all know that God remembers his promises. We all know that God remembers his word. He remembers his people. This isn't a recognition that God forgot. It's Nehemiah calling on God from the position of his heart, the brokenness of his heart, the struggle within his own heart, calling on God to remember his word and his promises. God's doing that already, but God's using that prayer to realign Nehemiah's heart to trust in God's word, to trust in God's promises, to trust that God is for his people. We saw last week that Nehemiah's prayer sprung from a heart that delighted in God's name, that longed to represent God's name in the world and to long to see God's name be made known in the world, to be worshiped in all of the earth. We saw that Nehemiah's prayers included requests for missional success. Like, God, make me successful and give me favor with people. And we're going to see today, especially with that king. God, give us favor. Lead us, guide us, give us success, give us favor. And as Nehemiah fasted and prayed these things, God worked to prepare Nehemiah and others and his circumstance to bring Nehemiah into the work of building. So Nehemiah felt called by God, called to help, called to rebuild, but it was clear through a lack of resources that the time was not right. You ever been in that place? You're like, man, I've got a burden for this. I sure hope God sends somebody. Or, I've got a burden for that, and I know he wants me to do something, but I have no idea. It's just too big. It's too big. Or, I just don't have the resource to do what God has put a burning in my heart to accomplish for him. Anybody else other than me ever feel that way? I can remember feeling that way when I was stepping into church planting in New Orleans. You know, it was my wife and I, and at the time, two very little kids, young children, and we actually had another family, I'm not knocking them, sweet, precious people, who had committed to go with us as a part of the team. And we got down there, and about 2 weeks after we got there, they called and said, we really feel like this isn't what God wants us to do. We had an organization that promised us, I can't remember if it was $30,000 or $50,000 in startup money. And in church plant life, that's big money, okay? That's big money. And that was promised ahead of our time there, about a month after we got there. We're like, okay, we've been here for a month. We're in our rent house. We're spending our money left and right, trying to figure it out, trying to develop partnerships. When is the check coming? Oh, we've decided that we're not going to write that check, right? And there were several other things that happened that about 3 or 4 or 5 months in, we go, did we miss it? I mean, Lord, did we miss it? And it was a season where the Lord was like, no, draw near to me, call upon my name, wait on my provision. I'm going to do things that are beyond your imagination. And so, you know what? Nehemiah felt this call. He felt called by God. He had a lack of resources. The time didn't seem right. But notice the line in verse 1 that says, I took up the wine and I gave it to the king. You see that? Nehemiah's fasting. Nehemiah's praying. That never stops. But Nehemiah's also busy doing what he always had done. He was serving as the cupbearer to the king. He was going about his daily task while at the same time fasting and praying and waiting for God to enable and empower the work that was on his heart. It was in this waiting time that God prepared him in the ordinary, everyday realities of life as he fasted and he prayed before his God. You know, oftentimes I'll have people in churches prior to this, I had tons and tons of young, like college-age students in our church and seminary students, and they would all often come and say, man, I just don't know what God wants me to do. I think I'm going to quit this and go seek what God might want me to go do over here, and I think I'm going to jump off this ledge and take this, and I'm going to figure out what I'm supposed to be doing. And I was like, hold on. Slow your horses for a second. Do you know where God is leading you? Now, there's times where God calls us to take a leap of faith. And it's into like scariness and a lack of provision. Like God makes that clear. You know, in church plant life, when we left where we were to go plant, God made that clear. But oftentimes we get ahead of the Lord. When God places something on our hearts, like his calling first and foremost is for us to sit before him and to pray and to allow him to prepare us. You know, there's countless people that sat and prayed. There's a prophet in the Old Testament. God called them out into the wilderness. And he sat by a stream. The stream dried up. Sounds familiar. And the birds that were feeding him like flew away. And he's sitting there by himself. And in that struggle, God said, hey, I got some things to say to you. And then he sent him on his way. Even Jesus himself, before he began his ministry, went out into the wilderness and prayed and fasted and waited for the moment when it was time for him to step in to the work that God had prepared him to do. So when you don't know where to go, when you don't know what to do, but God's placed a burden in your heart, give yourself to the work of waiting well, of fasting and praying. So Nehemiah continued to do these things to the best of his ability for the glory of God while fasting and praying for the people of God and the city of God. And God was faithful to prepare him. He was faithful to get him ready, to prepare even the circumstances around him. He continued to do the things God had given him to do to the best of his ability. So, real quick, I want to draw a distinction. There will always be times of waiting on God to move. There will always be those times in life. There's often space between the moment God lays someone on your heart and the moment he fills your mouth with the right words to say. Sometimes it surprises you at some stranger at the grocery. There's very little time. But more often than not, God will place someone on your heart, something on your heart, and there's space and time there. There's often time between your, I think almost always, but often time between your sense of calling and the next open door. And God in that time is preparing you. So what does God accomplish in our, and here's how I want to term this, active waiting. Our active waiting. What does he accomplish through prayer and fasting? That's what we're here to talk about today. That space in between. When we're fasting and praying, what does God intend to do? So we're going to see that in the text this morning. Write this down. It's truth number one. God focuses us on his mission. So in our active waiting, not passive waiting, but in our active waiting, through prayer and fasting, God focuses our hearts and our lives on his mission. Look with me. Verses 1 and 2 say, in the month of Nisan, in the 20th year of King Artaxerxes, when the wine was before him, I took up the wine and gave it to the king. Now I had not been sad in his presence, and the king said to me, why is your face sad, seeing you are not sick? This is nothing but sadness of the heart. I don't know about you, but I'm easily distracted. So if I'd gone from 1 month to 4 months later, God had pressed something on my heart, I think it would have maybe waned a bit. I'm easily distracted. Work, the kids, family life, the various activities that we have going on, even busyness and church life, just life in general. It competes for my attention. Any amens out there? Amen. If I'm honest, so does my phone. It competes for my attention. As a matter of fact, it demands my attention. It calls out to me minute by minute, asking for my attention and my affections or whatever. And it's easy to take my mind and my heart off the calling and the mission that God's given me and He's given us to do. 4 months is a long time. Aren't we always typically doing our very best to move as far away from negative feelings as we possibly can? Anybody else know that that's true? We think, well, so-and-so died, or such-and-such happened. I've got to move away from this. I've got to move away from this. I've got to get over this. And we're moving there. But sometimes God puts us in a place of tension for a season to develop something, to do some good work. As a matter of fact, most of the time, the suffering that the world brings to our door, God is repurposing and reworking to shape us and mold us and do good things. And I think if I'm honest, I'm running to my phone and to my distractions to forget. I'm doing my very best to like solve the problems that are in front of me so I don't have to deal with them anymore so that I can move along. But hear me, when God puts a burden and a sense of calling on your heart, don't run, lean in. Don't get distracted and give yourself to other things. Now, I'm not saying at all that there's anything wrong with focus time on the kids and work and activities. All these things are incredibly important and needed. But sometimes our hearts and minds and lives are dominated by these things to the extent that we leave very little room for Jesus and for His calling and for what He's the burdens that He's placed on our hearts. Fasting and prayer keeps our hearts and our minds and our lives focused on the burning that God's placed in our hearts for His people and His mission. In the text, it's clear through Nehemiah's countenance before the king that after 4 months, the plight of God's people and city and His calling to help is still burning in his heart because he's not stopped putting these things before the Lord. Day and night, and day and night, and day and night. And the light of God's holy passion for the things of the Lord and the people of the Lord and the church of God and the kingdom of God is growing in Nehemiah's heart. It's not fading in Nehemiah's heart through distraction. He's working. He's doing the things that God's called him to do. He's staying in place. But the activity of his life, day and night, was fasting and prayer, so that his heart would remain hot for the things that God had placed on his heart. Write this down. It's truth number two. In our active waiting, through fasting and prayer, God readies us to speak up. Now, this is, for a lot of people, terrifying. We actually see it's kind of scary for Nehemiah here in a second. But in our active waiting, through fasting and through prayer, God readies us to speak up. Verses 2 and 3 say, "Then I was very much afraid." Why? Well, he's before the king. He had a sad face on. In his role, he wasn't supposed to have a sad face. It's not like he was a jester, but he was definitely supposed to smile and bring the wine to the king. And it says, "I was very much afraid and said to the king," and you can imagine this is sort of his knee-jerk reaction, like, "Why are you sad bringing me my wine? Let the king live forever. Why should not my face be sad?" Now, that's not what you expect. You expect him to say, "May the late king live forever. I'm so sorry. I'll put a smile on my face." It's kind of backing out the door. "Here's your wine. Have a good day." But no, that's not what Nehemiah did. Nehemiah says, "Let the king live forever. Why should not my face be sad? When the city, the place of my father's graves, lies in ruins, and its gates have been destroyed by fire." So during a joyful festival, the king asked Nehemiah about the sadness of his heart. He says, "You're not sick. I don't see any sickness. So why is your face sad?" Nehemiah's countenance had revealed, whether he intended it to that particular day or not, Nehemiah's countenance revealed his burden. Nehemiah's countenance revealed his passion. Nehemiah's countenance revealed his call. The way Nehemiah was walking in the world showed that he had a heart and a passion for the things of the Lord and for the Lord. It was on his face. The question, though, he's in this pressure moment, terrified, scared Nehemiah, because his job was to bring wine to the king at the party. The expectation was that Nehemiah would do that joyfully and happily. And if Nehemiah was a drag on the party, if you know anything about Old Testament kings, he could be severely punished. So when Nehemiah carried his sadness on his face before the king, evidence of his calling and his passion and his longing before the king took notice, and in a brief moment, it shook Nehemiah. Nehemiah was scared. But here's the thing. Nehemiah had been waiting for this moment. Now, realize the tension in this. He comes before the king, sad face. Probably that day didn't mean to show his sad face, but he did. The king noticed, and Nehemiah is shook. He's scared. But in the middle of all of this, Nehemiah's heart is expectant. If you go back to the end of Nehemiah's prayer in chapter 1, you see that he'd been praying for favor and opportunity with this man. Nehemiah 1:11 says, this is the end of his prayer. O Lord, let your ear be attentive to the prayer of your servant and to the prayer of your servants who delight to fear your name, and give success to your servant today and grant him mercy in the sight of this man. Now, I was a cupbearer to the king. That's the man. Give me favor in the sight of this man. I'm a cupbearer to him. Give me favor in the sight of this man. Give me mercy here. So in the sight of this man shows that God had revealed somewhere along the line in those 4 months, through his consistent praying, his consistent fasting, some particular things. At the beginning, I don't imagine that he knew a whole lot of particular ways that God would move. But in that prayer and fasting, God opened Nehemiah's mind to some ideas. One of those ideas was that maybe God will use the influence and the power and the wealth and the authority of this king that I work with. He's placed me in a particular place at a particular time for a particular purpose. Surely God will use the truth that he's placed me in this particular place at this particular time with this particular purpose for a reason. And so he's been even putting the king before the Lord. So it's a scary moment, but it's a moment he'd been praying for. He didn't know when it was coming or how it would come, but he just kept serving and kept waiting for the Lord to open the door, and the Lord did. And Nehemiah's consistent fasting and prayer prepared him to speak up, to act when God opened the door. Write this down as truth number 3. In our act of waiting through fasting and prayer, God makes us dependent upon him. Lean in. In our fasting and in our prayer, like when this is a consistent part of our lives, God leads us, causes our hearts, causes our lives and our minds to be dependent upon him. We talk a lot about, in coming to faith in Jesus, we're laying down our willfulness, our self-leadership, our way, our truth, and our life, and turning to Christ and taking up his will and his desire and his power and his spirit. One of the primary ways that God gives us to tune our hearts and cause us to be led by the Lord is through fasting and prayer, is to root our lives in the work of prayer. God causes us to day by day be dependent upon him as we give ourselves to fasting and prayer. We know from Romans and other places that there's a war going on in us, a war to take up our own self-determined life and our own self-strengthened life and to walk in the way we want to go. Even if it's things that we think that God wants us to do, we have a temptation to do good things for God in our own strength and our own power and according to our own leadership. But can I tell you something? I think there's thousands of churches and thousands of Christians all over the world who are walking and leading that way, and they're powerless. Because we're broken. We're sinners. The only good that comes through the Christian life is when we're submitted to the work of the Holy Spirit and he's empowering our lives. verses 4 through 6 say, verse 4 says, "Then the king said to me, 'What are you requesting?'" And the text says, I love this sentence. "So I prayed to the God of heaven." So what are you requesting? This is a conversation. And he doesn't leave and then come back. Like, he's having a conversation with the king. The king says, "So what are you asking? What are you requesting?" I prayed to the God of heaven. Zero in on this moment for a second. The instant the king asks, "What are you asking?" Recognize that Nehemiah hadn't asked for anything. He hasn't. There's been no request. But God, who Nehemiah has been calling out to and asking to work in the king's heart, had clearly put it in the king's heart to ask Nehemiah what he needed. God had caused the king to love Nehemiah in some form, to respect Nehemiah in some way that would lead him, when he sees a sad heart, to say, "What is it that you need? What is it that you need?" God answered Nehemiah's prayers that he prayed back there. And now, in a moment where Nehemiah is shook, where Nehemiah is scared, where Nehemiah is in a situation before the king, and the king asks the question, the king says, "What are you asking?" And Nehemiah hasn't asked anything, but God put that in the king's heart. Now, you know, Nehemiah spent some time during those 4 months dreaming and planning all the what ifs. You know, I imagine it was kind of like God puts it on his heart. It's kind of like, what if I won $1 million? What would I do with it? Anybody ever had those thoughts? If I won the lottery — I don't play the lottery. You may play the lottery. I don't play the lottery, but I wouldn't suggest you do that. I don't think that's a super good idea. But if you won $1 million, you know, and you think, what would I do with that? You know, you start thinking, well, you know, I'd pay my house off. You know, I'd give it to the church. I would, you know, maybe put some money in for the kids for college, you know, and then I'd take a vacation and buy a couple of cars that aren't 15 years old. And then, you know, so you kind of get some plans rolling in your head, but then you pray about it and you're like, God, that's not God's will. You know what I mean? You know what I'm talking about? Come on, you can confess. You've had those thoughts before, right? Just raise your hand up. You've had those thoughts. Some of you are lying. It's fine. It's totally fine. Now, I kind of feel like a similar thing probably happens here with Nehemiah. He hears the news. He's praying and fasting and praying, not in an excited way, but kind of in a fear and admiration and like under the hand of God sort of way. And he's like, what might God do? And he's thinking, well, maybe God could do this, and maybe God could do this. And there's a lot of thinking, and he's putting all sorts of things before the Lord over those 4 months. And, you know, if God lets me do this, if God lets me lead this, well, I'm going to need some wood, and I'm going to need this, and I'm going to need that. And so there's all kinds of things that I imagine Nehemiah's thought. Notice anyway, no matter what all those thoughts were, he'd been praying for opportunity with the king. Maybe he had made some plans for his big ask, if he ever had the opportunity. So you'd think he'd just, on the question, pull out his list of things and say, thanks for asking. I got a list of stuff. But that's not what Nehemiah did. That's not what happened. The text said, so I prayed to the God of heaven. Lean in here. Prayerfulness begats prayerfulness, begats spiritual dependence, begats power. That's the way it works. Prayerfulness leads to more prayerfulness, and it leads to greater spiritual dependence. And whether it's ahead of time or right in the moment, prayer prepares you to pray, and prayer prepares you to walk in the power of the Spirit and speak by the power of the Holy Spirit. I don't know about you, but in situations like this, I often speak first and pray later. Anybody else? Yeah, I bet. But here Nehemiah pauses before the king, big crowd, queen sitting there. Nehemiah pauses to engage his heart and his mind in prayer. This is the habit of his life. It's the rhythm of his day. It's how he lives. And so he's in this tough situation. He's in this tough moment. And he takes a deep breath, and within himself, he prays. Now, I don't know what the prayer was. I imagine, depending on how long he was willing to stand there and pause before the king, I imagine it was something like, all right, God, here we go. Speak through me, empower me, help me. I'm here, I'm ready. I only want to speak what you speak. But I'm going to guess it probably was a few less words than that because he's standing before the king. I imagine it was more like, help, you know. I'm here. It's time. I'm ready. Lord, help, speak. I imagine in some way there was a settledness because of his previous prayers. So I don't think it was probably freaked out help. I think it was more like, because when you have conversation with someone and they're close and they're near, it's more like, all right, Lord, help. You know, if you've fallen off a cliff and you're hiking and there's no one around, you're yelling, help. But if the Lord is near, and you've been walking closely with him and you sense his nearness, you're in that moment in that conversation and you go, all right, Lord, help. Here we go. This is the moment. Lord, help. Powerful ministry and opportunity led and empowered by the Holy Spirit is prayerful ministry led and empowered by the Holy Spirit. Prayer and fasting and those seasons of active waiting causes us to be dependent even when those moments are hot. And the power of the Spirit of God comes alive and bubbles up and blows through our minds, our hearts, our souls, out of our mouths, in worship, in declaring the gospel, in leadership meetings with the king. You know, you can be in a meeting and feel all kinds of conflict, be criticized and struggle, dealing with all sorts of difficulty, and pause for just a second. If you're consistently praying, if you're consistently fasting in prayer, and say, God, now's the moment. And those of us that think with our lips, some of you know who you are. This is me. That's hard. It's hard. It's hard because we process out here. There's a need for us to draw back, pause, and say, God, help me. And then there's some who don't process here. They all process in here. And instead of going to the Lord, they just go straight to worry and concern, and they're fretting and thinking, what am I going to do? How am I going to do this? The immediate, if we're living a life dependent upon the Lord and fasting and prayer, the immediate, no matter how you've been made, the immediate response is, oh, Lord. Oh, Lord. Dependence upon the Lord. Write this down as truth number four. In our active waiting through fasting and prayer, God emboldens us to take the necessary risks. Say that again. In our active waiting through fasting and prayer, God emboldens us to take the necessary risks. Notice Nehemiah 2, 5, and 6 say, and I said to the king. Not before he prayed. After he prayed. Not before he was led. As he was led. And I said to the king, if it pleases the king. The only way it pleases the king is if the God has changed the king's heart, prepared the king's heart. So I think Nehemiah is relatively confident here. And I said to the king, if it pleases the king, and if I have found favor, and if your servant has found favor in your sight. So if you see me as a faithful servant, if you've seen something good in me, if you've seen something that reflects God in me, and God has done a work in your heart, like this is kind of the flavor up underneath Nehemiah's response. If it pleases the king, if your servant has found favor in your sight, that you send me to Judah, to the city of my father's graves, that I might rebuild it. If God's put favor in your heart towards me, if God has burdened your heart along with mine, could you please send me to Judah to rebuild the city? Now, this is risky. I don't know what it takes to replace a cupbearer, but the cupbearer is a pretty important job. We talked about this last week. The cupbearer eats and drinks the food of the king as a protection against the king's death. The cupbearer is someone who the people prepare the food, he eats the food, drinks the wine, and I don't know how long, but it comes before the king, and the king eats it, and he dies before the king dies. Like, this is an important role. You have to be an incredibly trusted person to be the cupbearer to the king. And if you read the story of Nehemiah, I don't have a sense of whether, like, he had to call the king back up and say, hey, I didn't make the time frame. I'm not quite done. I'm not going to be back in time. But there's an issue of the time, and there's some agreement that happens. But in the middle of all of this, like, there was a risk to Nehemiah to step in and to make this ask. The king could have said, no, no, I'm not going to do that. We've done all of this work. Who's going to replace? I'm putting my life at risk to send you back. And so there was a risk for Nehemiah to make a request like this. But in Nehemiah's fasting and in Nehemiah's praying and Nehemiah's like living before the Lord, we've already seen some really good and powerful work that God does. Nehemiah's been submitting to the Lord. He's been recognizing the awesomeness of God. He's trusting in God's promises and steadfast love. He's reaffirming his commitment to obey no matter what. He's cried out to God for help. He's done this continually. Nehemiah's done all this work before the Lord. He's become confident in God's calling. He's become passionate about God's work. And when God opened the door before the king, no risk was too big for Nehemiah because Nehemiah had been walking before the lordship and awesomeness of the king. No obedience was too shaky or too scary or too terrifying. Not even the risk of losing his life for the sad face. None of this was big enough compared to the awesomeness of God and the greatness of God and the passion that God had placed in Nehemiah's heart. No matter what, I'm going to join God in the work of rebuilding this wall. There was no powerful fear in Nehemiah. He was willing to take the necessary risks to trust in the Lord. You know, in our context, there's also, we talked about this a few weeks ago when we were in the Psalms. In our context, we find all kinds of things. All kinds of things pop up in our lives that lead us to fear instead of walk faithfully. We fear that if I step into this or I go on this mission or I step into this work that my family is going to be neglected. Or if I invite these people in and I do life with these particular people that my children are going to be influenced. Or we think, well, maybe I'll lose my job if I step forward and I say this and I do this and I walk in this way. Or maybe like I had a difficulty, some difficulty with some things, but now I feel like God's calling me to do it. And I said that I had some difficulty with things, these things, but God's moving my heart. And if I turn, then these people that I said I had a difficulty about it, they're going to think, well, you changed your mind. Like, what's wrong with you? I thought we were on the same team. There's all kinds of things that go on and stir in the human heart that put us in a position to fear man or to fear self or to fear like impact or influence of the world on us that keep us from walking the steps that God has put in front of us. Keep us from obeying the things that God is calling us to do. Keep us from taking the necessary risks. But Nehemiah said to the king, if it pleases the king and your servants found favor in your sight to send me to Judah, the city of my father's graves, I'll go. I'll rebuild it. Send me. We ought to have that same sort of fearless faith born out of a relationship with an awesome God. We live under his lordship and his power and are led by his spirit. And when God calls, we step in and step up. Truth number five, write this down. In our active waiting through prayer and fasting, God gives us wisdom to navigate the complexity of his calling. God gives us wisdom to navigate the complexity of his calling. Anybody ever been under the illusion that if God calls me to do something, it's going to be easy street? Anybody out there, you've ever thought, well, if God calls me to do something, it's going to be simple. It's going to be easy. I mean, he loves me, right? Nehemiah 2:6 says, and the king said to me, the queen sitting beside him, how long are you going to be gone? And when are you coming back? Now, the king's got an agenda too. He appreciates Nehemiah. He's got all kinds of things. But he says to Nehemiah, how long is this going to take? When are you coming back? Like, this isn't like, oh yeah, here's the stuff. Have fun. See you in the next life. You know, that's not the way this worked. There were some complexities and some things that Nehemiah had to deal with, had to confront in order to obey the Lord. And so Nehemiah, I don't know if he left and then came back, or if he, on the fly from a position of great prayerfulness from the plans that he had made before the Lord, I don't know what transpired to bring him to a place to give an answer. But he says, so it pleased the, so, but he gave a time, and it says, and so the, it pleased the king to send me when I'd given him a time. You know, the reality of Christian ministry, the reality of God's mission, the reality of building the kingdom, of making disciples, the reality of investing in others, the reality of investing in the life of the church, loving God's church and loving the lost and loving the people of God. We've talked about this, but it takes risk, but oftentimes it's pretty messy, and it can be pretty complicated. It can be complicated on a whole host of fronts. It can be complicated out there in the world as we're dealing with opposition. It can be complicated with those who are seeking to enable our mission. It can be complicated with the people that we're on mission with. We're actually going to see some of that with Nehemiah. Some of the people that were in the land when he got there, there were complications. Some of the people that he went that went with him, there were complications. There were difficulties and complications and struggles and ups and downs and lefts and rights and opposition. And there was all sorts of things. Not everybody liked God and Nehemiah's plan. There were questions about it. When are you going to get back? How long is it going to take? How long am I going to have to do this? How difficult of a thing should I have to bear? How much time will this take? I mean, there's all kinds of questions. Well, I have this preference. I have that preference. I have this thought, or I have that thought. And man, God has put us all together. He's leading all of us. His Spirit is in all of us. We need the input that God is bringing forward from the entire body of Christ. But let me tell you something. It can be a bit messy. And can I tell you, when you step in to the mission of God, to the ministry of God, and we as the church are a praying and fasting and Spirit-depending people, when we come to those moments where it gets complex and we need wisdom, we're pausing, we're praying, we're trusting, we're talking, but in the end, in all of that, we're seeking the wisdom of the Lord for the good of His people, for the good of His kingdom, for the good of His church, for the good of the lost around us. God, give us wisdom. When new vision and new direction begins to become clear in a church, you know, I think that this is normal. This is the first time I've ever experienced this. But when a big change happens, especially in a pastoral change, there's folks that don't like it initially and then they go. And then there's people who stick in and then they struggle. And then there's people who like jump in and they dive in. And in time, like things change and they morph and they change and they morph and God's making things clear. And it can be really confusing. It can. It can be really difficult and confusing. The answer in all of that is us leaning into the Lord, not making anything we came up with supreme, but just to come before the Lord and recognize His word and collaborate together and trust the leaders enough to allow them to lead, but also to trust them enough to come and speak to help readjust and redirect. But in all of that effort here at Anchor, we really need the wisdom of God. We need the wisdom of God. Can I tell you something? The wisdom of God leads us to speak face to face. It leads us to put our name down and take ownership for our feedback and our encouragement in the body. It leads us to come to the elders and have conversations if we're upset about something. And it leads us to walk in wisdom. That's what being led by the Spirit looks like. That's what it looks like. It looks like, God, empower me. God, help me not to be afraid. God, give me a voice. Help me to not speak according to my flesh. But here I am, face to face. And let me tell you, we need God's wisdom and we need God's power in those moments. There's several of you in this room I've grown to deeply love. Now, a bunch of you. But there's several of you who we've wrestled with some things over the last 2 years. And because you've come face to face over and over, man, my affection for you has grown and grown and grown and grown and grown. And our elders and our leaders in our church, like the direction at times has even been guided and wisdom has been given when brothers and sisters come and help us in humble, spirit-led, and wise ways. When we're fasting and when we're praying and we're spirit-led, God gives us wisdom and discernment to navigate the complexities of the work of his kingdom. And beautiful things happen. It's not to say that God doesn't lead some to go. God, we pray that every single person that's in the body, he would keep here. If he doesn't, and he has a different will in a different way, we trust him. But Lord Jesus, please help us to walk those moments and those seasons out in a way that's led by the Spirit, that's navigating complexity, that's wise. I hope that you pray for the leaders and for the body, that we would walk that way together as we seek to embrace the things that God's doing in our church. Write this down as truth number 6. God gives us a vision for our work. In our active waiting, through fasting and prayer, God gives us a vision for our work. Nehemiah 2, 7 and 8 say, "And I said to the king, if it pleases the king, let letters be given to me to the governors of the province beyond the river, that they may let me pass through until I come to Judah, and a letter to Asaph, the keeper of the king's forest, that he may give me timber to make beams for the gates of the forest of the temple and for the wall of the city and for the house that I shall occupy." God did some work in Nehemiah in those 4 months. There was a bit of a plan that did develop under the lordship and kingship and like sovereignty of God in Nehemiah's heart. There were some particular things, some particular ideas that developed as he wrestled before the Lord. And when it came time to make the particular asks in this process, Nehemiah says, "I know that I'm going to need a house to live in when I get there. And I know that we're going to need wood for the gates. And I know we're going to have to pass through the forest. And I know we're going to have to," whatever. You know, he's got all of these different things and all these different plans. And there's some particular things related to the vision, related to the plans, related to what God had called him to do, that Nehemiah already knew that he'd need. And Nehemiah says, "O king, here's some things related to the vision that you've placed, that God's placed in my heart, that I'm going to need." And he spoke those things before the king, and the king granted those things. Praise God. But can I tell you, I think that Nehemiah had the foresight, was prepared to make the particular asks because God had given him a vision as a part of his calling. Big picture vision, God, Nehemiah, I'm going to use you to rebuild those gates and I'm going to use you to rebuild those walls. Big picture. In our church, we've not been given the liberty to develop a mission. God's given us one. "Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe or obey all that Christ has commanded." He's given us a big picture mission. It's clear. Nehemiah had a big picture mission. He had a heart, a broken heart for the people of God. He had a heart for the worship of God. It was unprotected in the temple. There was a need for a wall. So he had a heart to build that wall. And God, through time and through prayer, gave him particular vision that he would need to build a house, that he would need to have lumber, that he would need these particular things to execute his plan. And I think it was through that season of fasting and prayer in those 4 months as the Lord did his work that God made the vision clear and God made Nehemiah's steps clear. In our active waiting, through fasting and prayer, God leads us. He gives us a vision, that is, a plan, a way, a focus to our work of making disciples of all nations, of all peoples. Write this down. It's truth number 7. This is the last one. Last week it was like 11. You get a break today. It's only 7. So good job. So in our active waiting, through fasting. I know some of you were thinking that. I know some, we got to like number five, and then I said number six, and a couple of you in the back of your heads went, is this another 11-point week? And I didn't give you a heads up. If it's going to be 11, I'm going to tell you at the front. But seven is about the most I'll give you without giving you a heads up. So that's just so we have a sense of it. That'll be our little agreement moving forward. If it's seven or more, I'll give you a heads up. If it's not, it's going to be under seven. Most of the week, it's going to be three or four. So last one, write this down. In our active waiting through prayer and fasting, our good God guides and empowers us. The last line in Nehemiah 2:8 says, and the king granted me what I asked. Can you imagine? Nehemiah's like, ha! Look what happened. And the king granted me what I asked for. Not because Nehemiah did anything special. Not because Nehemiah was special. Remember, we learned in week one, Nehemiah's an ordinary guy. For the good hand of God is upon me. Anchor Church, do we want to be the sort of church where God does things beyond our imagination because the good hand of God is upon us? Do we want to be that sort of church? This was in my notes, but I missed it somewhere because you look up, you look down, sometimes you miss some things, but I'm going to say it here at the end. I really think the difference between a church that's walking in the power of God and seeing the kingdom unfold in the world and a church that loves God but is a bit apathetic is what they do in the space between God's impassioning and calling and the movement of God. That space. God gives us his mission. He stirs a passion in our hearts. Sometimes it's up, sometimes it's down, but he's always, through the preaching of his word and through our time in the word, stirring a passion. But the question is, what am I doing between the stirring that God has done in my heart, the call that God has placed in my life, and the time that God begins to powerfully unfold his mission in my life? And that can look like a conversation with one person where you're sharing the gospel, or it can look like the way that God's enabling you to make disciples, or it can look like some challenge the church has and we're praying and we're asking God to give us direction, to lead us and help us. But that space between here's the challenge, here's the calling, and here's God's clear movement. The difference between a church that is on the sidelines of God's kingdom plan and a church that's unfolding God's kingdom plan is whether we're actively waiting before the king. Fasting and praying and contending and encouraging. Doing what we already know he's called us to do. Faithfully. Because it's not like we're not supposed to make disciples. We're doing our best with what we know right now. But as we fast and as we pray, God gives us big dreams. He gives us a vision. He changes our hearts. He prepares us. He begins to work in others, in our community. The fact that there's all kinds of visitors coming in the door, there's a bunch. If we had them stand up, I wouldn't do that to you. You're new. We're not going to tee you up. There's, if we said it, if you're new here in the last 3 months, stand up. If we did that, there'll be a bunch of people in the room. The fact that God's doing that, and we haven't done much. We haven't. God is beginning to do something and stir something here. I think I want to draw a direct line to Sunday morning at 9 o'clock and Wednesday night at 6:30. And among those discipleship groups who are going before the Lord in prayer, I want to draw a direct line back to those things. I think we are beginning to see God move, not because we're all doing everything the way we're supposed to be doing it. We're getting better at those things. God's doing some different things. But because there's people praying. Because there's people praying. Because there's people fasting and praying and crying out to the Lord. Because there are brothers and sisters in our church who day by day are submitting to the Lordship of God in prayer, recognizing the awesomeness of God, trusting in God's promises and steadfast love, reaffirming their commitment to obey the Lord no matter what, crying out to God for help, praying continually day and night, praying for other people over and over, confessing sin together as a part of prayer, calling upon God to remember His word and His promises in people's. Like, they have a hearts that delight in God's name and desire God's name to be worshipped. Like, they're praying for missional success. They're praying for favor. Like, there's people in the church that are doing that work. If you want to get in on the work of the kingdom, lean into what we know God has called us to do. Let's do it. And lean into praying. And trust God. Because the best days, nothing against any days behind us, because there were good days, but the best days are in front of us. And I for one, don't want you to miss it. The best days are in front of us. Believe that. The best days are in front of us because there's people praying in ways that are powerful and beautiful and good. So I want to encourage you, come Wednesday nights, pray personally with your families, for the church, for people around us. Like, ask God. Pray like Nehemiah prayed. Ask God to do great and powerful things. And He will move in you and prepare the circumstances around you for Him to unfold His kingdom through us in this place, this time. Let me pray for us. Father, thank You so much for Your word. Thank You for this time that we could unfold Your word, consider the impact of Nehemiah's prayer and fasting, consistent prayer and fasting. Lord, help us to not be a people who are apathetic in our waiting. Help us to be a people who are not just waiting for whatever God's going to do on the sidelines. But Lord, I pray that we would be a people who are contending before the Lord in prayer and through fasting and trusting that this great and awesome God wants to work in me and through me to do great things in the world. Lord, we do lift up the men and women and boys and girls in our community. Our community is made up of all kinds of people from all nations, tribes, and tongues. You've brought them to this space and this place in Gwinnett County, Georgia. And You've placed Anchor Church at this place, at this time, the people that are in this room for a purpose. We don't understand all the details, but we know You've called us to make disciples of all nations and to baptize them and to teach them. Lord, there's all kinds of complexities that are woven into the reality of making disciples in a community like ours. But You are a great God. We trust You. We love You. God, do whatever work You want to do in us so that You can do whatever work You want to do through us in this world. We want to live lives of worship. Lives that are surrendered and submitted to the King of Kings. We worship You, Jesus. You are great. You are mighty. You are good. It's in Your name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand and respond to the Lord. Strength within sorrow. There is beauty in our tears, and You meet us in our mourning with love that casts out fear. You are working in our waiting. Sanctifying us when beyond our understanding, teaching us to trust. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You are with us in the fire and the flood. Faithful. God, through our fasting and through our prayer, God, we come to you and we ask that you would come down and be with us, God. Be with your people, unite us, let us go out. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. You're dismissed.